please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
So the UIDAI has introduced certain new safety features. I wouldn't be wrong if I say that UIDAI in terms of safety has gone for an upgrade. Will this upgrade be able to assure people on their safety concerns? To discuss that and much more, I've got the CEO of Aadhaar, UIDAI, Dr. Ajay Bhushan Pandey. Dr. Pandey, thanks very much for speaking to us. I hope you will take all the questions, particularly regarding safety concerns. First of all, I want to know from you, what is virtual ID? Because, you know, initially when we got information about this, it was pretty hard to understand what exactly is this safety net that UIDAI has started. Because it appears as if there is one more layer of work that needs to be done by people.
You know, let me first explain to you, this virtual ID is like your camouflage Aadhaar number. Because if you are going somewhere and if you want to prove your identity, then you give your Aadhaar number and then you are asked to give either the biometrics, or if you are entering into some online, you want to prove your identity online, then you enter Aadhaar number and then you get an OTP on your Aadhaar linked mobile number. So what used to happen is that there are many people who used to feel that their Aadhaar number, I have maintained that it is not a secret information, it is a personally sensitive information, just like your mobile number or your bank account number. The question was that can we make this personally sensitive information, which is not a secret information, even then, can we make this, the further secure? And for that purpose, we have added one more layer on the Aadhaar number itself. So, and on this, we were working for last 1.5 years. This whole concept is not that, it has come just overnight. We were working for the last 1.5 years. And this is the biggest innovation done since 2010, ever since we launched Aadhaar project. So this is this. After 2010,
it's like an upgrade.
Complete. I mean, it's like a Aadhaar 2.0. This is the kind of feature that has come. So what will happen with the virtual ID is, let's say you have Aadhaar number, and you go to our portal, and you the first time you enter your Aadhaar number, and then because our portal, so we will maintain So what we will do is that on the portal, you enter Aadhaar number and then we'll send an OTP on your registered mobile. And then you can generate a 16-digit virtual ID number. Now that becomes your alias Aadhaar number. Now wherever, if you have to authenticate yourself, either through your biometric or through the OTP or through your iris or whatever manner, there, in place of Aadhaar number, you can use your virtual ID, right? And then give your virtual ID, give your fingerprint, and then your authentication is done. So the agency which is requiring your authentication, for example, let's say you have gone to a telecom company for getting a SIM card, or if you have gone to a telecom company for verifying your mobile number, or if you have gone to a bank and you want to verify your bank account, then you don't have to give your Aadhaar number. You say that I have a virtual ID. And you give virtual ID and give your fingerprint. And Aadhaar system will know that this virtual ID belongs to this person. That is number one. One more thing that I would like to clarify. This virtual ID is changeable. You can change any number of times. I mean, let's say you generate a virtual ID and you use it, and then next hour...
How many times can I use one virtual ID?
First of all, any number of times till you change it. It's like, your password. The password is valid till you change this.
Okay. So this essentially, from how I understand, is that it's not a virtual number applicable to any one service, which means I can create one, use it,
to mask my original Aadhaar number exactly. as long as I want, and then I can change it also.
Exactly, exactly. And then one more, there is also one more very important thing that we have introduced in this one is that when you use virtual ID to use Aadhaar authentication, then the agency which is accepting your virtual ID, that agency today, he gets your eKYC information.
Yeah.
And that eKYC information has the same information which is there on the Aadhaar card. Basically, he gets your electronic Aadhaar card. So what in this whole system, what we have done is that on the other end, that agency will get a different series of number, and it will be a much longer number and string of characters.
What if the company tries? What if the company tries to trace it back to whoever's Aadhaar has been used?
You see, the company will not be able to trace this because the company will not get the Aadhaar number.
Okay, so they'll just have the 16-digit number.
They, you know, they will have a 16-digit number, but the 16-digit number you will be changing, and then the UIDAI will send a response to that company. Saying that this particular person has authenticated, and here is the KYC information, that is the name, address, and other details which are there on your Aadhaar number. But at this point of time, we are sending only the Aadhaar number. So what we will do is that the agencies also will not get Aadhaar number, except those agencies which are by law required to get Aadhaar number.
Okay. Okay.
So let's say, you know, there are many agencies which are, you know, which want to, which want to confirm your identity using Aadhaar, right? Because Aadhaar creates a trust.
Yeah.
Because, you know, if you're using Aadhaar identity, then the agency also has a trust, and you also can, you know, get these services, and it also empowers you. So, but then the, if this agency is not mandated by law to keep your Aadhaar number, then to such agencies will not give the Aadhaar number.
Okay. Dr. Pandey, I want to stop you here. Say, for instance, again, we are dealing in a hypothetical situation, because I hope you realize that there'll be many in this country who will be wondering at this moment when they listen to you. You're saying agencies for whom it is mandatory for you to share your Aadhaar ID, they, for them, you will have to give your original Aadhaar number. Others who do not need it can make do with a virtual ID.
No,
if they don't need it, they shouldn't get it.
No,
that option, that power you have given to the people. What if, say for instance, tomorrow, these companies come out and say and make it mandatory for people that no, we need your original Aadhaar card only to provide you certain service?
No, that time then the law will take care of this. See, the law, because it is under only a law that they are requiring the Aadhaar number, right? The law. Now, for example, telecom. In case of a telecom, there is a Supreme Court order which requires that the person's mobile number should be verified with the Aadhaar authentication. Let's talk about the authentication, where you give your Aadhaar number and you give your fingerprint. There you can give the virtual ID. But tomorrow, if the Department of Telecom says that as per their policy or as per their law, these telecom companies need to do Aadhaar authentication, but they need not get the Aadhaar number.
Okay.
So then the UIDAI would not give them the Aadhaar number, and then the mobile subscriber also will not give them the Aadhaar number. So mobile subscriber will give them a virtual ID, and whereas UIDAI will give them some different, we are calling it this UID token, which will be a 72 character string, which will be given to them, which will be also be unique, but from there they will not be able to trace the exact Aadhaar number.
But that's the point, Dr. Pandey. What all is mandatory at this moment? What all services are mandatory at this moment for me to give my original Aadhaar number and details? And where all can I give a virtual ID card? Do you think that there is ambiguity on this front?
So all those ambiguities will have to be, but each service will have to be wherever, because right now we have given Aadhaar authentication facility to more than 300 agencies. So each agencies will have to come and explain, saying that under this law, they are required to collect Aadhaar number and also do Aadhaar authentication.
Just for clarification, agencies, you mean service providers, say for instance, like
banks, telecom.
These are agencies.
These are the agencies. So each agencies will take a review and we will say that, look, you know, under what law you are required to get the Aadhaar number and do Aadhaar authentication.
So as of now, come March is when this rolls out? I presume. As of March, say if I were to say that I only want to give my virtual ID card, and I don't want to give my genuine number, then how do things go about from here?
So we have a transition plan. From 1st of March, you would be able to use your virtual ID number everywhere, regardless whether under the law they are required to get Aadhaar number or not. So let's say a bank, and tomorrow if the government says that yes, the bank will should be able to get Aadhaar number, but you can continue to give your virtual ID to the bank. We will give Aadhaar number to the bank. But supposing, you know, if you go to let's say a telecom company, and government says that the telecom company should not get Aadhaar number, from should not compel a mobile subscriber to give the Aadhaar number. So there you can give your virtual ID, and we will also not give Aadhaar number to the telecom companies.
Dr. Pandey, now for the safety concerns, right? This is to understand.
Now, before that, let me clarify that. Now, we should also remember that in our country, you know, there will be a huge population which will say that they will not be able to, they say that I am not able to handle this virtual ID number.
Very interesting. You touched upon this point.
Then in that case, can I use my Aadhaar number? Of course, because this is an option given to a person that either he can use his Aadhaar number or he can use his virtual ID.
You know, it's interesting that you say that, Dr. Pandey, because only yesterday we were speaking to a few people whom perhaps you might want to categorize as the naysayers for Aadhaar. They feel that this will add another level of bureaucracy in the life of an Indian, because now it will give birth to another tout who will say that, do you want a virtual ID card? We'll create it for you. One more layer of work or bureaucracy. How do you respond to this fear?
That is completely a wrong conception. Supposing if I have an Aadhaar card, I can continue to use Aadhaar card the way...
This is an option.
Yeah, the way I was using before and forever, right? I can give my Aadhaar number and I can put my fingerprint. For me, there is absolutely no change. But again, there are some people, you know, who may feel that, you know, I would not like to give my Aadhaar number to anywhere. Then they can generate a virtual ID. Then there could be some people... who may feel that they need to change their virtual ID every day. So they can go and change every day.
How many can I change?
I mean, you can change as
unlimited.
Many, right? I mean, every hour you can change, every second you can change.
Dr. Pandey, safety. Safety is a big concern for people. Now, the biggest problem over here, or to a lot of people who we spoke to, they said, you may have created a virtual ID, but will safety also remain virtual, or will safety be real?
See, I've always maintained that we give a maximum importance to safety and security of data, because we have data of 1.2 billion people. We have their basic demographic information, and we also have their biometric information, right? And we have, for many reasons, we don't discuss the various security measures that we have put in place, particularly our internal security rings. There are rings after the various layers of the security, and then there are lots of security layers which we don't want to discuss. But and we keep on improving the security, because security is never a static situation. And security answer can't be said in a Boolean manner, in a yes-no matter, that is your system secure? Can your system not be hacked? Now, such questions cannot be answered in a yes and no manner.
Would you like to elaborate on this?
When
you say this, what do you mean?
Suppose, for example,
if I were to ask you a question, is your system hackable?
So what I'll say that, you know, if you ask this question to any IT system in the world, the answer would be that, you know, the answer to this, you know, such questions can't be answered in yes and no manner, because every system, like for example, can you say that, you know, any port can't be breached, can some at some place can you say that there cannot be a criminal breach into the system, right? What one can say that, yes, we have taken maximum security measures to make it very, very hard to do this. And that can be judged by your past track record and also the kind of measures that we are taking. Now, if you see that during the last 7 years, what, you know, we have been constantly upgrading our system. And when we upgrade our system, doesn't mean that our system was vulnerable as such, right? But yes, we found that, you know, okay, this is some area where the security should be improved. So we keep on improving it. For example, when we brought this, you know, virtual ID system, so does it mean that till yesterday, you know, people were living in insecurity? The answer would be no. But then we also keep on improving and bringing new measures of security so that make the things harder and harder. If it was hard yesterday, now it becomes
harder today.
And then we should do something else so that it makes it,
no,
makes
but then,
it
you
further
know,
harder.
Dr. Pandey, the concern over here is, say for instance, what is the philosophy behind virtual ID? That a person who need not, you know, who's not mandated to have your information should not have the information. It is optional for you whether you want to share it or not, right?
That's correct.
This is what I'm assuming. Now, here's the thing. What is the guarantee that you can give to people that by sharing my virtual ID, no one will fraudulently store my data in their database? You know, there have been concerns. There are some companies who were trying to, in the name of KYC, were trying to get more information or use that to far more than what was required. So can virtual ID or creation of a virtual ID or a system like this lay to rest such fears?
Let's see.
Fraudulent use of my information.
Yeah, so you see the kind of instances that came to our notice, for example, that your Aadhaar number or KYC was done for one purpose. And then they used it for some other purpose.
Yes.
This is the kind of complaint that was coming. So naturally, it is a not only a violation of Aadhaar Act, it is also a criminal breach of trust. For example, you know, if I have given you certain information for one purpose, then how can you use it for some other purpose? Let's say, supposing, and that's what, and this is a larger data protection issues. For example, you know, you go and, you know, apply for a certain service. Next day, you start receiving certain calls, telemarketing calls. So naturally, your data has gone somewhere else, right? So this is also a larger data protection issues. And for that, there is a committee headed by Justice Sri Krishna, in which, you know, I'm also one of the members. So we will also look at, you know, all those data protection issues, which will also cover Aadhaar. So that the purpose for which, you know, you have given your data should not be used for, you know, any other purpose. And if that happens, then whether certain legislative changes are required, legal actions can be taken. All those things will have to be worked out.
Okay. The creation of virtual ID, again, these are media reports. We have seen it. We have reported them also. Does the creation of a virtual ID practically make it difficult or impossible for, say, someone to access my geographical data? Is that possible?
See, first of all, you know, Aadhaar does not collect your geographical data. Because, see, when you do authentication, we do not collect the purpose of this authentication and from which place you have done this. You know, of course, Aadhaar will have to know that, you know, that this particular authentication request has come from this agency. Now, but for this agency, it has come for what purpose? For example, let's say you have gone to a bank. And you have, you are doing Aadhaar authentication, maybe through the virtual ID or through your own ID. Now, it could be a bank employee doing attendance, you know, Aadhaar-based attendance, or doing some kind of a transaction, or doing some balance inquiry, or opening a new bank account. Or maybe you did some Aadhaar authentication, and you later on you decided not to open a bank account. So we have absolutely no information about the purpose of the transaction, and also whether you opened a bank account, what bank account details that you had. One more thing I would like to clarify, that, you know, some people have this impression that UIDAI, if you link all your bank accounts or telecom mobile number, your PAN card, then UIDAI gets all information, all, you know, every information about your bank account, all your mutual fund, all your stocks, PAN card, all your properties. Mm. This is completely untrue. Mm. UIDAI only has your information about what is there on your Aadhaar card. Mm. That is the name,
so
address, and other details.
This is the only information which is in any case in the public domain that goes out.
Yeah, because your identity, you see, mm. you know, when we talk about this identity,
okay.
see, your identity consists of your demographic information mm. and the biometric information, mm. right? Your name, address, phone number, mobile number, email, and photograph, and then you have a fingerprint and an iris. Mm. So this is the only data that we have. We don't have the data about your bank account, your data have about your about your mutual fund or mm. your stocks or mm. the PAN card. So when people are talking about this so-called data breach, I will mm. still call it so-called data mm. breach. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, if they are having the impression that, you know, some data breach has happened and his mutual fund information or his, you know, the bank account information, the bank password and the bank login and then the ATM card and ATM PIN information has been accessed through UIDAI, this is completely untrue because UIDAI doesn't have that information. Mm. And if you don't have the information, then where is the question of breach?
Okay. Dr. Pandey, many thanks for joining us.
Thank you.